I was not recording. So I mean, it's important that you follow all this stages to your to the drawing, and you document them. That way, I can, when I check tomorrow the work, I can see that you're following along or trying to understand what I'm doing. See, this is, I'm just working the right along the edge here, right along the border between the light and the light and the shadow. Yeah, this, right, this is form shadow. So this edge should be softer, but it's also gonna, this is also gonna be some of the darkest values in your drawing. Now, like looking at the cast, the cast of the eye, I mean, there's value in this area, so I can bring some of this value even further out here. But see, you start to see this area start to form. This darker area. So we're working on the features of the face, and like I mentioned yesterday, I believe I mentioned it, I want to after doing these, I want to do a whole face, and I'll go over the proportions to the face also tomorrow, depending on how much time we have. And we'll be drawing some of the cast of the face that we have. And again, you know, I would encourage you to come to class here. I think that's, it'll be more beneficial learning this process by looking at the actual cast rather than just the photograph. See, I keep going over this, and that becomes the turning. Now, for those of you guys here on the in the studio, see up there, those are the same, those are my drawings that I took photos of and I emailed to you. And see there, I've got the sphere right in the middle. I've got the two spheres, and so you see that dark area. That's what I'm trying to do here. Of course, this is not as perfectly spherical as like a sphere, but you still see some of those areas on here as well. Or like the cylinder, you see the cylinder there, that you've got the light, the dark, and you've got that very dark value down the center. That's what I'm trying to do here. And I mean, there's many ways of shading, but this is, I think, a better way that will give you a fuller, I think, more realistic looking drawing. So yeah, I've been working on this wall here, those drawings, for a couple of years, trying to make it so that it's easier for the students to kind of see what I'm talking about, and just to help them in learning the process of drawing. Now, Samantha, look at how I'm drawing. I don't know what you're looking at, but you want to draw vertically like this. And you can, there's drawing boards. You can put a drawing board. And also like, what's your name? Annabelle. Annabelle? You want to get closer so you can draw the cast that we have. And I'm going to continue bringing this value down here as well. Adriana is waiting. And see this value that I had here, it's becoming reflected light. Again, if you look at the notes up here on the wall, or the notes that I asked you to copy, you can look for those areas so that this makes more sense. And see here, the turning here gets cut because you've got the thickness of the upper eyelid, but then it continues over the ball of the eye here. I'm sure you guys have some questions. Don't be afraid to ask, you know. I'm not gonna get mad if you ask a question. And see there that gave the eyeball a lot of form, you know, just by darkening that value there. And see, to get it more accurate, I'm also, it's better to go across the form, but sometimes to make it all sharp, it's okay to kind of do this here. But you don't want to make it way too sharp. And there might be some of that turning along this, along the tear duct here, this right here. And that value that had looked so dark, now it looks a lot lighter. And when I start to work on the background, you see that I'll have to go back and make a lot of readjustments. That's just the process of drawing and of painting, you know, constantly having to revise. Now see this. This is folding over, so I would say even along this edge here, to make this look more, you know, more round, I'll add some of that value here. Now this, see, there's some details here that are supposed to describe the hair of the eyebrow, right? But you always want to work, you know, general to specific, you know. So first, I'm gonna disregard, you know, these shapes. And because this edge is form shadow here, I'm going to do this. I'm going across the form and it darkens this area. Starts to create that turning. And see, it got darker there. And like I said, sometimes it's okay to do this, just kind of follow the, you know, depending on the, how angular, you know, how angular or how round the form is, that will determine how sharp we see this, the turning here, like here looks pretty sharp. it's becoming more three-dimensional. It's looking more convincing as a three-dimensional form. Now there's also the light's hitting right here, very, very bright. And then there's all these details here that give the eye the expression, the muscles on the brow of the face are they're very tense. So they create all this kind of wrinkles and crevices. But you want to keep in mind, this area, it's curving. You can run your hand or your finger across your brow. You can feel that it's very, very round. So that's how I'm going to shade it first. Emphasizing that general form, not looking at all the details, Well, before I keep going here, let me take a picture. This is what I want you guys to do, to show me that you've done all the stages that I'm doing, shadow shapes, and then focusing on the turning, that dark value. See, first I'm just emphasizing the general values. So here, this is probably the only area that's going to remain as white as the paper right here. Because it's already, because I gave it some value here and also the background. It's already looking a little, looking more illuminated. But I'm going to go back. This is from the darkest area to the lightest area. Putting more graphite around this. I really want to push the dark values here. And it's, very light touch, just constantly layering more graphite, more and more graphite. And see this, remember this value was the darkest, right? And see, this is kind of getting lost here. I'm gonna kind of redefine this shape. So this is a very, you know, organized, you know, step-by-step method. And it ends up giving your values a very structured look to it, which I think it's always is good to have, you know, in your, you know, just make your drawings better. The way that I've set it up here, you know, I have a spotlight. And of course, this works with one spotlight where you have, you know, just one shadow, one strong shadow. But, you know, working in this way, organizing your values, organizing your lights and your shadows, you do this enough in this kind of setting, then you start to see it in any kind of light, in any kind of setting, any kind of lighting. And see up here, there's a little bit of a, I guess it's the edge before you see the top plane of this cast here. That is also very, very dark, this line up here. You see, right now it's because I went over it. It looks I'm kind of losing the turning that I had done, and so I can try and map it out again here. But I'm trying not to make it in a way that it's just a sharp line. I want to, because it's not a line, you know, it's just an area of value here. Now, as an artist, you want to be able to direct the view of the audience. You want to be able to tell people you should be looking here, you should be looking there. And you can do that by the amount of detail that you emphasize in your drawings. And I think it's always a good idea to tell the viewer, you know, look at the light more so than the shadow. So what I like right now, it's almost no details on the shadow, right? I'll put some details on there, but it's, but the majority of the work's going to be on the light areas. And you always want to remember that in the shadows, what you have is, you know, like if I turn off the lights in this room, what happens is you have loss of clarity. And when you have loss of clarity, you lose details. So just with that, you know, you can really simplify the what's going on in the shadows. Now I can bring some of these values. See, there's down here, I've got the there's kind of bag under the eye here. These are not shadows, you know, these are half lights, dark lights. It reveals the form of the eyeball under the eyelids here. You see, this is this looks rather flat, this area here, but there's you know, this looks also like it's more rounded here and here as well. And see, from this area, it starts to make the, even though it's cut out here, this area makes the, it's part of the side plane of the nose. And so the strokes that I'm gonna do here to emphasize that, that angle that it, that, you find here. And this is part of the eye socket here, so it's pretty deep here. So right now it's just general areas of value, still not focusing on the details. See, this value, even though it's not shadow, it's pretty close to the shadow mass in its appropriate value. Let me switch to another pencil here. Can really push this into the eye socket, this area. And the stroke is like I'm, carving. I'm carving into this paper. See, this should be a little darker as well here, right along the edge here. There's a lot of value here in the in this white, cast. See, right now it's looking, starting to look darker than the background. So you might say I'm running the risk of over shading or over modeling. It's starting to look like he's got like a tan. But you'll see like in a little bit, I'll darken the shadow and the background, and then it'll look like it's brighter. Now up here also, I kind of missed this area. But this is also form shadow. At first, it's kind of hard to draw like this with on an easel, because your hand is just kind of floating, and your arm is just floating in the air. So you might feel your arm burning a little bit. We get used to just like putting our hand right on the paper. So this is the eyeball. Now there's pretty much value all over it. You see the stroke kind of emphasizing the roundness of it. There's a little bit of a streak of white here that's more light facing. And I want to push the values even darker here on the light mass. And see now I am going to, see I had mapped out the topography of this area, so I'm starting to kind of deal with that a little bit more. But see, still in a very general way. And I mean, I always tell my students, you know, I hope you guys are enjoying this, because I mean, this is what it's about, you know, drawing, just shading and I myself enjoy this tremendously. Like, man, it's probably, I mean, I can't complain. I've been pretty lucky with my, I've had some really good experience as an artist. I think this, getting paid to do this is, can't complain, you know. So I hope you guys are learning something and having fun. Yeah, this is what fun looks like for an artist, you know, just not like we're jumping up and down and screaming. But see, this is where the action happened, right here, this area. That's why I keep going over it and over it. And now I can also start to go in here in some of the what would be the dark accents. You know, like here's very dark area. Again, part of the eye socket here. Very deep. It's also a very dark value here. And see, right here, there's like a, I still see a little bit of my previous drawing here. And see this, there's a plane. I don't want to switch over to my ebony pencil, but I might have to. See, there's a very sharp area here, almost like a line. And within this shape, there's this, the fold of the upper eyelid. There's that area. This is the turning on the round, on the edge of the upper eyelid here. And see this gets a lot of reflected light, and I'm gonna darken this area here. See, now that I made this darker, now this doesn't look as tanned, it looks brighter. See, now I'm just, for the sake of time, I'm going to move on to the ebony pencil here, which is like a 4B pencil, but try and be very careful with this. And so I can work a little bit faster with the values here. See, I don't want any sharp lines in the shadow mask, just kind of blurry. You know, emphasizing what I had said about that we have loss of clarity in the shadow mask. And what happens also, like if your eyes look into the shadow for a long time, your pupil will dilate and start to get more detail. You know, open up and there's more light coming in, so you see more into the shadow. Use my brush to blend this. See this area that I'm shading is the wall, so it's flat. So I can do strokes. You know, up and down and sideways. I want to keep this really flat and this really, really round, more three-dimensional looking. I think that the way that you laid down the strokes of the graphite, it'll help emphasize that. See, and again, take this value and spread it out to give the background some value here. It's only so fast I can go with a 2B pencil. See, I'm combining it with the ebony. I want to recover the shape or re-emphasize this shadow shape here. See, now it's looking more illuminated. Go back over with the brush to even it out. Take a step back, see how this looks. Still needs another 5 hours of shape. Take a look. See, this is the light is very strong here. But I think the ear itself is darker, it's lighter than this. Well, no, shading a little bit of like what I did, like just setting up an image and shade a little bit of the background so that the ear stands out.
So I'm gonna continue.
Or do you still have the pieces of like the sandpaper?
Why yes. Who needs sandpaper? Mm-hmm. But you have to have the lead exposed a good amount like this. But this is how you would. So you get your sandpaper and your pencil and you put it here on top and you turn it. You want to get your feet out of the whales. And see, it'll sharpen it. Now you don't want to press down like this where you have the lead on the sandpaper in your hand over here, because it'll break the lead. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you have to carve it with an X-Acto knife or some kind of a box cutter like this, so that you can expose more of the lead. Like this. And sometimes, you know, it happens a lot with charcoal pencils. Like if you drop them, the lead breaks inside. Not so much with graphite, but it does also happen with graphite. So you expose the lead, that way you can sharpen it.
Question.
Yes.
Did you buy the powder, graphite powder, or do you save it from the shaving, from the filing?
I have both. Yeah, I bought some powder, graphite, and I have a huge pile of graphite dust from sharpening the pencils. Yeah, I have both. Yeah. Yeah, make sure that you upload images of your work to your blog so we can talk about it tomorrow. So for homework, you just have to finish this drawing, you know, using the photograph that I gave you. And also, but by this time you should have done all the back all the work from last week as well. We've had enough time to get everything caught up. See, now I'm using my ebony pencil to add some of the darker values here. I'm going to keep working on this for maybe another hour, recording it, or until my stomach starts to growl, you know. Then I'll take a break. It's 11:16, so if you guys have to leave the meeting or the class, I mean, you can. You're dismissed. Can't forget the eraser. Comes in handy also. This is the line that is carved into the eye here.
After working in this eye, I'm seeing things that I didn't notice before.
Like what?
I don't know, the shadows that the eye makes.
Details. Oh yeah, the details of the eye, right?
Yes, correct.
Yeah, that's one of the great things about these casts. They make you aware of a lot of anatomical information that you don't see on a photograph. I encourage you to come and draw here, because there's a lot more that you see when you have them in front of you, not just the photograph. I mean, if you're able to. But that's why for a while I had been wanting the department to buy these casts. They're great, great tools for learning. See, now I am just focusing on the small details here. See, from this angle, I can see the inside here of the eyelid, and you see, whatever you observe in these casts, all these details, you want to memorize them. And when you're doing a portrait of somebody else, you're doing a self-portrait, you want to add these details that you're observing here. And that makes your drawings more, have more information, be more informed. And that's what a lot of those artists like Rubens and were contemporary artists, you know, you had more information, not so much because of what you're seeing with your eyes in front of you, but things that you've learned, things that you've observed in statues and other paintings. Sometimes you look at artist work and you're like, what are they doing that I can't do? And it's this kind of practice of looking at casts, looking at statues. It's not just having a lot of natural ability as an artist, it's a lot of study also. It's kind of crazy, the expression on the eye. I mean, it's so like intense and kind of troubled, you know. It's like such a masterpiece of statues, you know. Yeah. Yeah, it's constantly adjusting and redrawing and erasing. I gotta erase a little bit here, some of these reflected lights. I don't want them to be that bright. Go over them with a brush. You too. See you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Professor.
Yes.
The drawings, the reference drawings for the sphere and all of that, where I can get them. The ones that you said to write.
Okay, I can, I'll email them to you. Yeah, because, yeah, it's on the announcement for the class, but you can't access the Blackboard, but I'll email them to you.
Thank you.
Also, do you have the, remember, I have a blog.
What is that?
There was a blog that I think I would use when you were in the painting class.
Is the same one?
Yeah, I think they should also be on there.
The last time I checked, it was only, but let me check again.
If you check like on the earlier post, it should be there. Yeah, and if it's there and you can get them from there, just let me know. If not, I'll email them to you.
Okay, thank you.
But yeah, this, I'm gonna stop the video. I think this is done.
Okay.
You have any questions about this?
No, thank you.
Okay, all right.
Bye. Hasta luego.